Exercise number 6. Practice DEFENSIVEPESSIMISM. If you can't exhibit optimism and often sabotage your efforts, try defensive pessimism by imagining the worst and preparing for it. The next time you find yourself preparing for a situation that produces anxiety, come up with a list of everything that can go wrong. If it's a job interview, you could jot down getting sick, being late, forgetting important details about the company, forgetting the fundamental things you should know when applying for adjuvant position, wardrobe malfunction. Then, address every item one by one by coming up with a list of possible solutions and implement them to reduce the risk of the setback happening. Here's an example: getting sick. If possible, avoid crowded places with a higher risk of an infection prior to the job interview. Eat foods and engage in habits that boost the immune system, such as exercise. Get sufficient sleep. Being late. Leave much sooner than necessary. Ensure that your car doesn't need any important repairs and won't suddenly break down. Charge up your phone so you can call a cab if you can't turn the engine on. Forgetting important details about the company. Visit the company's website and memorize everything you find interesting or good to know. Read the most recent news. Find a current employee and invite them for coffee to get insider knowledge. Forgetting the fundamental things you should know when applying for adjuvant position. Review the basics of your profession. Read a book or two about the most important concepts pertaining to your job. Wardrobe malfunction. Prepare your clothes the evening before the job interview. Bring a second shirt or even an entire second set of clothes with you. Assuming that everything will go wrong and then making sure that you have a contingency plan will help you overcome anxiety, build confidence, and avoid self-sabotage. Point 2. Strategic optimism. Strategic optimists deal with the anxiety of failure by adopting the outlook that things will end well. Instead of worrying themselves sick about their future performance and trying to plan for every single possible setback, they set high expectations, visualize success, and feel calm and in control. It takes a lot of practice to adapt this strategy if you've been a pessimist for a long time, so start small and stay patient. The process comes down to three steps. 1. Shifting your locus of control, the extent to which you believe you can control events that affect you. 26. From external to internal. In other words, take responsibility for your life instead of blaming everybody but you for the failure, and admit that you've achieved success thanks to your efforts, not through luck. We'll talk about locus of control in more detail later in this book. Point 2. Slowly stretching your comfort zone. Start with easy tasks within your comfort zone and take it from there. A string of wins, even if they're tiny, will help you build positive momentum and develop the belief that things generally turn out okay. Point 3. Reframing. Optimists are masterful at changing the meaning of their failures. Consequently, they don't take them personally and maintain high confidence in themselves. For example, if they don't perform well during a job interview, they'll consider it a lesson that they need to better prepare for their next interview, or they'll simply tell themselves that if they didn't perform well, it was probably because subconsciously they knew it wasn't the right company for them. I dig deeply into the topic of self-efficacy, the strength of the belief in your abilities that can help you become more optimistic, in my free book Confidence: How to Overcome Your Limiting Beliefs and Achieve Your Goals. 3. Live in a fantasy world. This will sound like a contradiction to what I've said before about being realistic, but there's a slight difference, so please read carefully. I've been criticized that I live in a fantasy world on more than a couple of occasions. And I like when people say that because it shows how far I've gone. And my attitude, which previously was as pessimistic and self-limiting as you can get. As much as I value being reasonable when setting new goals, I don't set limits for myself as to what I can achieve given enough time, and neither should you. This is a crucial tool to escape self-imposed mediocrity that is caused by the erroneous belief that you aren't the master of your own destiny. This is not about believing that you can become a millionaire in 3 months. It's about believing that if you want it to happen, you will make it happen, although in a more realistic time frame. In other words, you believe that everything is possible, but you don't keep your head in the clouds. I have a corkboard in my home office with some of my favorite quotes, and right in the center of it there are two quotes. 1. Nothing is impossible for a man who refuses to listen to reason, From Gary Halbert, a legendary flamboyant copywriter who is responsible for some of the most successful direct mail campaigns. If you're reading this book, I assume you're doing so because you want to build a better life for yourself. This in itself runs contrary to the behavior of a large group of people who couldn't care less about self-improvement. Understand that you'll meet with adversity and disbelief because it clashes with how those people see the world. You'll be the unreasonable one in their eyes, but don't let it define your self-confidence. All successful people have to deal with this point too. To live an extraordinary life, you must resist an ordinary approach. From Frank McKinney, a self-proclaimed real estate artist, international best-selling author, philanthropist, and ultramarathoner, who has built oceanfront spec homes, homes built without an identified buyer, valued in the tens of millions of dollars. I often reread these quotes to imprint them even deeper in my mind, but what's more important is actually taking action in line with what they espouse. Namely, it's refusing to accept the self-limiting beliefs imposed on you by society. It's about not following the herd right over the cliff. It's about developing trust in yourself, because you're the expert of your own life and what you want it to be like. You won't always be right, but what's important is that you did what you thought was right. I'd much rather fail because I made the wrong choice than because I listened to someone else. In more practical terms, this means things like quitting a lucrative job that you hate, to do something that actually gives you joy and doesn't convert your life into a nightmare. Reasonable people would probably say you should stick to a lucrative job. It's such a bad job market, you should be happy with what you have. But in the end, is life really about money alone? Or hey, maybe the point is to be happy and fulfilled, going against the tide when you believe it makes sense. Most self-published authors undervalue their work by selling their books for $2.99. Readers often buy such books on impulse, skim through them and forget about them right away. I first broke the mold by pricing my books at $3.99 and $4.99 and then going as high as $7.99. It's only a few bucks more, but paying two or three times more for a book suddenly makes a reader respect their purchase more, standing out, even at the risk of ridicule. Obviously, it's not about putting gone underwear over your pants just to be different. A great example here is Dollar Shave Club founder Michael Dubin, who created a slapstick YouTube video promoting his new company. Instead of taking the common and boring professional angle for his commercial, he chose humor and sarcasm. Within just 4 years, it paid off handsomely when he sold the company to Unilever for $1 billion in cash. Adopting these two outlooks on life will help you develop more trust in yourself and, consequently, overcome, or at least reduce, the occurrence of self-sabotaging behaviors.